infinite depths of darkness can be sliced open by light. And for the finite expanses of the miracle called life, it has but one delicate vessel. Earth. It has been here a long time. The light has gently bathed this beautiful complex membrane faithfully. Mankind is the only form of life to step back and take a long, hard look at our only home. Our intelligence has brought us here, and it has also brought us much closer to another world within us. And within this universe, ironically, lies the blueprint for our future. Cancer. It is a biocode gone wrong. It is delighted by what we do to feed it. The menu we've provided for these creatures is becoming more extensive by the day, except that one human being found a way to close the pantry doors a long time ago, in 1928. This is that story. The famous naturalist John Muir once wrote, "If one pulls on a single thread in nature, you'll find it attached to everything else." For this 15-year-old boy named Garrett, he rediscovers that fact from different angles regularly. He lives with his father in a remote section of Alaska, where traveling in bush planes is almost routine. From these vantage points, the health of forests, wildlife, and even glacier melt can be easily observed. For Garrett, his sensitivities about nature are acute. His eyes have already seen nature in the raw, with many obvious questions answered before he had time to actually read about it in a book. As far back as he can remember, his family has worked with orphaned wildlife, and so his understanding of biology was hands-on there too. Thanks in part to a special book written by a Dr. Max Gerson, he understood how important it is to feed a young creature such as this porcupine the right mix of foods, or that creature would succumb quickly, especially in its first few days of life. Regular visits to our neighbor Bob provided this unpasteurized goat's milk. No store could legally supply this. Bob's wife, Margaret, is recovering from breast cancer. But she recently heard from Garrett about Dr. Gerson. And then word spread in the community about this Gerson therapy. People that were deeply impacted positively included the mayor, the local electrician, the banker, the hammer museum guy. Then there was the beekeeper, who saw links to the Gerson therapy that extended even to the health and productivity of his bees. There was also the artist, the people at the organic store, and then a Gerson tape was obtained.
There are laws against healing cancer. The doctor is not allowed to try anything else. He must use only those treatments that have already proven to be failures. Imagine what we could do if this could be accepted. But there are laws against it. You're not allowed to heal. There's too much money to be made on drugs.
For Garrett's diabetic neighbor John, this message came too late to save his legs. But perhaps Bob, the milkman, had the best observation about the Gerson therapy.
What I'd like to see is some proof, some good scientific proof.
When a cruise ship came to town, many visitors would come to learn about the wildlife that Garrett cared for. He found it surprising how unfamiliar most people were about wild animals and their requirements. The news of this situation eventually got back to Dr. Gerson's daughter, Charlotte, who sent Garrett a little gift. It was a new book written by Charlotte that spelled out how Dr. Gerson's therapy worked. It had easy-to-understand statements about cancer. Even a 15-year-old could find the text a good read. The chapters were profound and seemed too good to be true. Points are made that sparked curiosity to learn more. This moment was about to become a new chapter in Garrett's life. Up to this time, reading a book cover to cover was a rarity for him. But in this instance, it was different, due partly in what the book addressed. It was what he observed day to day, even when doing the most mundane chores. What Garrett had not fully realized was the implications of the potency and power contained in vegetation. What seemed like a simple snack taken for granted in the garden had tremendous implications worldwide. If Gerson's therapy was accepted and implemented, it would help change the history of mankind's modern agriculture, food supply, healthcare systems, economy, and of course, the environment. Then Garrett learned a lesson in being misunderstood one day when his father cleaned the house and tossed an artwork piece Garrett had made into the trash. Because of its unusual design, the community garbage collector fished it out and gave it to local police, who declared it a bomb. Definitely a blow to Garrett's creativity. Other situations then took their toll on the boy, and Garrett's straight-A record sunk. His father decided he needed to be homeschooled. His first homeschool lesson was about Dr. Gerson and...
I'd like to see some scientific proof.
The boy wasn't sure how that would be accomplished, but he did draw out an analogy between gold mining and human nature to start with. He decided the best place to start his research would be the public library. It didn't take much time before he located several independent sources that confirmed important points as outlined in Dr. Gerson's original classic book. From those important leads, the dubious characters that make up the history of the use of fluoride fascinated the boy. He dug for more information, and then more skeletons were uncovered. Then Garrett began to assemble a general outline of what needed to be accomplished to successfully confirm the Gerson protocol. It was when the words about hope were written that I made an inquiry to become involved in helping him document the integrity of the Gerson therapy.
First, there's Gerald Cox, who worked for the Mellon Institute of Industrial Research. The Mellon Institute, by the way, was the leading defender for the asbestos industry. Gerald Cox became interested in the fluoride from the suggestions of Francis Frary, the director of the Aluminum Laboratory of Alcoa. And then came a leading scientist in toxicology, Dr. Harold Hodge. Harold Hodge was the one who oversaw injecting plutonium and uranium in people.
Harold Hodge studied the questionable safety of fluoride, but under the combined pressures of the Atomic Commission and aluminum manufacturing, he had to say it was safe.
Harold Hodge, along with a group of scientists, helped develop the atom bomb.
I am. Will represent 1 mile on your camera. The top part, 2 miles. We're going to switch to another camera. I'm going to move out of here.
3, 2, 1, 0. The shock wave will arrive in the control point area in approximately half a minute.
And then came Edward Bernays, the nephew of Sigmund Freud, the wizard of public relations.
Selling fluoride for public water supplies was easy for Bernays. He used the slogan, "Trust your doctor." To this day, even fluoride tablets are dispensed to children, thanks in part for the need to use fluoride to build the atom bomb. Parallels can be drawn from this history to another in the making about cell phones. A $28 million grant was given to Dr. George Carlos in the 90s to prove cell phone safety, but instead he found otherwise. He refused to be paid off. Cell phone transmissions are still a concern as to how they affect insects.
Do they teach this in public schools?
But when it comes to dental health, diet, not fluoride, can play a huge role. This became vivid for Garrett as he assisted on minor surgery of his tame wolf. The perfect cavity-free teeth of the wolf pointed to facts in a book he had just finished studying from the library. It was called Nutrition and Physical Degeneration by a distinguished dentist named Dr. Weston Price. Dr. Price traveled the world with his wife in the 1930s to visit native cultures that had never been exposed to modern civilization's diet of white flour, canned food, and sugar. To his amazement, these people averaged less than 1% of tooth decay. And Dr. Price noted something else. None of the people in these different tribes and cultures practiced any sort of dental hygiene. Not one of his subjects had ever used a toothbrush. But once processed food was introduced to them, tooth decay and disease followed, and it was the beginning of the end of the uniformly hardy and strong. Dr. Price studied animals with improper diets. Two-headed calves, deformed cats were the result. He also observed a direct link between human skull formation and diet. And yet, in present day, the subject of fluoride is still debated. In the state capital of Juneau, Alaska, I met up with the city's chief dental officer.
For the state of Alaska's position on water fluoridation, the Department of Health and Social Services and Division of Public Health support water fluoridation. But in Alaska, it is a local initiative. And what's going on in Juneau is a local vote on Juneau resuming water fluoridation. So while the department supports this, this is really a local issue. And I'm also involved with the Citizens for Dental Health Coalition, but that's not in my capacity as state dental officer.
Do you think that fluoride in the water will help prevent cavities and such? What is your position?
I think there's clear evidence over the past 60-some years now that fluoride reduces tooth decay.
But fluoride's only measurable effects on tooth decay are from topical application, not from drinking it. Hitler's alleged reason for mass medicating water with sodium fluoride was to sterilize humans and force them into submission. Garrett needed to see both sides of medicine. He then viewed compelling scenes from stock footage about Gerson I had already compiled.
If you think of basically what's in Gerson therapy, you really wouldn't expect it to cure cancer. So no, I don't think there's any evidence that anybody's ever been cured by Gerson therapy.
It's not right from any aspect at all.
Well, has Gerson therapy ever cured a cancer patient?
Oh, of course not. They won't even release their records.
There's absolutely no scientific evidence that he's cured anyone. Now, I've never interviewed any Gerson patients. It really is pointless.
But I had interviewed patients, and more than a couple. These patients had recovered from every type of cancer, and for many of them it was terminal. Orthodox medicine had given up on them and sent them all home to die. Some of them published books about their recoveries. I traveled all over the world, from Holland to Japan, and everywhere it was the same result, recovery. And even heart arteries can be restored. When Prince Charles spoke publicly in favor of the Gerson therapy after observing its effectiveness, he was skewered by the medical community. Nevertheless, I had observed his unwavering sentiments in a letter that was sent to the Gerson Institute. Charlotte Gerson routinely gives lectures about her father's famous therapy all over the world.
Dr. Gerson said two basic things are toxicity and deficiency.
Garrett was on the right track with his homeschool schedule, and what he had just seen drew him in even deeper. Now the world began to appear slightly more complicated to him. As he studied various magazine articles about the increasing incidence of cancer, he searched curiously and exhaustively for any mention of Dr. Gerson's therapy within mainstream media sources. Instead, what he discovered within the pages of any given article about cancer or chronic disease was a different approach to the crises, one that made him suspicious. Garrett wanted to learn more, and to his delight, the Gerson family sent him some long-forgotten film reels. Dr. Gerson's image with his family came to life. There was the discovery of footage of Charlotte Gerson in her 20s that captured his imagination within the historical reference of the where, why, and how this family eventually ended up in the United States from Germany. As a young doctor in Germany, Max Gerson's inspiration was Hungarian medical researcher Dr. Ignaz Semmelweis, who discovered that if physicians simply washed their hands between delivering babies, women would no longer die of infections. He was severely ridiculed for the suggestion. Ridicule followed Gerson as well after he discovered a cure for his migraine headaches and then tuberculosis by changing the diet. A clinical trial was undertaken with 450 incurable skin tuberculosis patients. None of them recovered at first, and Gerson was devastated. But then it was discovered that a nurse was sneaking pastries, beer, and sausages to the patients. The Gerson diet was then strictly followed, leading to the recovery of 446 of the 450 patients. Then, he discovered it cured cancer. In World War II, Gerson was able to flee Nazi persecution with his family to the United States. He continued to not only cure cancer, but other chronic diseases too. And when his close friend Dr. Albert Schweitzer suffered from diabetes, he cured Dr. Schweitzer as well, leading Schweitzer to assess and declare that Gerson was, quote, the most eminent genius in medical history. In July of 1946, Senator Claude Pepper held Senate subcommittee hearings over Dr. Gerson's cancer therapy. The astounding testimony was quickly reported by ABC News commentator Raymond Graham Swing over ABC Radio. The public's reaction was swift and favorable, but the broadcast resulted in the firing of Raymond Graham Swing 2 weeks later due to severe pressure by the pharmaceutical and American medical establishment.
I was investigated 5 times.
What do you mean by being investigated, sir?
From the ME.
They investigated you?
Yes, 5 times. Every time they come, I show them, here's the patient you sent home to die, cured. Other patient, you sent home to die, cured. Next patient, you sent home to die, cured.
And cure he did, including people with muscular dystrophy, like this young girl. Dr. Gerson's public lectures about his therapy were unpopular amongst his peers. For example, Gerson had spoken out against tobacco since 1920.
Time out for many men of medicine usually means just long enough to enjoy a cigarette. And because they know what a pleasure it is to smoke a mild, good-tasting cigarette, they're particular about the brand they choose. In a repeated national survey, doctors in all branches of medicine, doctors in all parts of the country were asked, "What cigarette do you smoke, doctor?" Once again, the brand named most was Camel. Yes, according to this repeated nationwide survey, more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette. Why not change to Camels for the next 30 days and see what a difference it makes in your smoking enjoyment? See how Camels agree with your throat. See how mild and good-tasting a cigarette can be.
And as more layers of the therapy were uncovered and understood, it was becoming clear to Garrett why there was such opposition to Gerson's therapy of caring for health.
The tobacco industry was the main source of advertising for the American Medical Association at that time.
Philip Morris was the Journal of American Medical Association's major source of advertising revenue. The editor of that journal, Dr. Morris Fishbein, attacked Dr. Max Gerson for, quote, treating cancer patients with diet and warning them against cigarettes. Fishbein originally aspired to become a professional clown, yet he never practiced a day of medicine or treated a single patient in his entire career.
Today it's no different. Chemical and pharmaceutical companies now run the American Medical Association and the FDA. The thing that bugs me is that people think the FDA is protecting them. It isn't. What the FDA is doing and what the public thinks it's doing are as different as night and day. A quote from Herbert Ley, the former commissioner of the FDA.
The boy remembered the superior effectiveness in a remedy his father had used on his foot, costly and toxic pharmaceutical treatments had not worked, but by merely dicing a few cloves of garlic mixed with raw honey, his foot problem disappeared. Raw honey also disinfected and greatly sped up cuts and abrasions. Another healthy, inexpensive item used that is non-toxic was hydrogen peroxide. It was used as a cleanser in the home and was even found useful cosmetically in hair highlighting. Garrett found putting 3% hydrogen peroxide in the ears for a time would even prevent the common cold. There are volumes written about natural cures and treatments. Knowledge is power. Garrett gave his orphaned moose calf named Franny her last bottle of goat's milk. And so Garrett's homeschool lesson went to a new level. It was time for him to take his homework on the road and put it all to the ultimate test. The entire foundation for Garrett's study and scientific analysis of Gerson's treatment commenced around breakfast with Charlotte Gerson in San Diego. Charlotte Gerson's son, Howard Strauss, and a distinguished guest who had just arrived from Slovenia also would join us. It was here that Garrett would compare his notes about Dr. Gerson's claims with unrelated outside sources to truly see if they match up.
Dental amalgam, and it's, by the way, dentists like to call it alloy because it makes it sound so much more stable. But dental amalgam is the biggest and the worst exposure to mercury that most Americans have in their lives.
If that is true, then millions of people have needlessly suffered a plethora of ills for well over a century and didn't realize the true cause was all in their heads. I was about to film a demonstration that proved this beyond a shadow of a doubt. Dr. Roger Eichmann and Dr. David Kennedy set up a phosphorescent screen and light that would be sensitive to mercury vapor coming off the tooth if it was present after even the slightest stimulation. We had teeth with amalgam fillings that would be placed in water of just room temperature to represent saliva in the mouth. I did not truly believe mercury vapor would come off the tooth, or if it did, that the film camera would register it. I also had a video camera on hand to record this event. My shock and horror, and as you can see, the 35mm motion picture camera did register the mercury vapor coming off the tooth. This is the first time in history this has ever been captured on a film camera. Make certain that what you are seeing is mercury, we had on hand a special instrument called a Jerome Mercury Sniffer to measure the levels.
What is 91?
190, show that to me, please. 191, is that high?
They'll close the factory and get over 100 and evacuate.
Oh boy, my gosh. Okay.
Now, you think about
turn
it.
Turn off
this,
the light.
This is room temperature, 1-2. At least 50 years old. It's been degassing for years, and many people have a whole mouthful of them.
Yeah.
Now just think what happens if you have half a dozen people in a elevator all degassing like this, and it's degassing 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Yeah.
And your OSHA standards are based on a 40-hour week.
Dr. Eichmann dipped his fingers in water to prove that this is not condensed water vapor.
Put my fingers in it. And if you notice, my wet fingers have no gas coming off of it. It's not water vapor.
I don't see anything that
you're seeing.
Next, Dr. Kennedy set up on the counter an amalgam mixer, which dentists use in their office to mix the amalgam capsules. And after mixing, they're broken open to prepare to be placed inside a patient's mouth as the amalgam filling. The amalgam capsules are then lined up one by one on a shaker where they are shaken for a time. With an unsuspecting patient nearby, the capsules are then broken open just as any dentist or dental assistant will do. Will mercury vapor be released? Remember, this is common procedure and goes on each and every day all over the world in dental offices next to innocent patients. The images speak for themselves. For the American Dental Association to continue to insist that amalgams are safe would seem absurd.
Turn on the light, can we see what we got?
252.
Yikes, should we exit this? Are we getting poison in here?
Yes, it's raised the room up.
Yeah.
The doors are working in a dental office.
The problem is now, if you go into a dental office to remove a silver filling, and they cavalierly start putting a drill on, this whole screen would turn black. You hit it with a high-speed drill, and you're going to put mercury everywhere. And those very small cuttings of amalgam will go all over. You've got to use a rubber dam. You've got to use a high-speed evacuator to get all that out. And you never should turn off your evacuator until the last piece is out of the mouth. Because as soon as you scratch on it, it's just like me scratching a knife on here.
Thank you.
I think it's a crime what they're doing to their dental staff. Is the female is much more sensitive reproductive-wise to mercury. And as a result, that causes not only infertility, but it causes birth defects. Of course, you get the usual denials, but when you look at the scientific literature, it is full of studies showing that exposure to mercury, either from your teeth or from working in a dental office, will, you know, you saw the demonstration, there's huge amounts of mercury in those offices. They don't monitor that, they don't warn the employees, they don't give them adequate mask and protection. And as a result, there's a tremendous amount of infertility in dental assistants. There's a documentary on it. It's about the Norwegian dental nurses and about their lives being devastated by their job when they were young girls. So I think it's a crime what they're doing to these young girls.
I've had patients come in from other dentists saying, gee, all I had was my teeth cleaned, and I feel lousy for days after that, every time. How come? Well, they polish the teeth. They get a huge amount of mercury being released for several days after that until you get a little bit of corrosion over the top, which slows it down a little bit. But the amount of mercury released is just phenomenal. And if they're sensitive to it, it'll put them over the edge. When I was in dental school, I was told that dentists were averaging their first heart attack by age 44. Our life expectancy was age 52. I personally related that to their use of mercury and amalgam fillings because it wasn't occurring in orthodontics and in surgeons.
I had made certain that Garrett was nowhere near this demonstration to ensure he did not inhale any mercury vapor. Yet that seemed absurd when considering that many people are walking around with amalgams in their mouths. Dr. Gerson was right all along. Dental health is paramount to healing from chronic disease. In Colorado Springs, Colorado, there is one renowned dentist who has spoken out about fluoride, dental amalgams, and even the dangers of root canals for decades. His name is Dr. Hal Huggins. But just before we were to meet him, Garrett fell into a depression. He couldn't seem to overcome the disturbing chemistry lesson about deadly methylmercury vapor that Dr. Roger Eichmann gave. This homeschool lesson had hit him hard. And then the cause of his sadness was revealed. The boy's parents had unwittingly allowed some dentist to stick the mercury inside his mouth too. He now saw himself as a biohazard. But the good news was that he was about to meet Dr. Hal Huggins, who would give him some reassuring direction.
Well, most of the people I see who are having their amalgams removed have some sort of a dread disease. But you're interested in prevention? Then you are 1 in 100 who's in a very good position because prevention is a whole lot easier than correcting a problem after it's occurred.
He asked how many dentists state that mercury fillings are safe.
Well, that would be pretty close to 100% if they want to be in dentistry tomorrow, because the Dental Association has certain rules and regulations that if a dentist is asked, is mercury toxic, and they say anything affirmative, they say, well, yes, it is. It's the most poisonous metal on the planet that's not radioactive. They're going to lose their license and be selling used cars the next day. So what they believe and what they can say, two different things.
Then he wanted to know which dentists know how to remove fillings properly.
Those people who go out and just have their fillings removed at random, by actual measurement, 63% end up with an autoimmune disease within 6 months that they did not have before they had their amalgams removed.
Dr. Huggins guided Garrett to a dentist that did know how to safely remove his filling. The boy remembered a question he had asked Dr. Huggins about retaliation for speaking out.
Yes, there have been a number of cases of retaliation. The first thing they did was put up an enormous amount of money to see to it my license was removed for refusing to place amalgam, for refusing to do root canals on patients, and writing a book they didn't like. There have been personal things that have been done against me and my family, which destroyed the family. The rest of it destroyed the business. They've destroyed everything I had except the mortgage on my home. And for some reason or other, they did not want that.
Garrett reasoned that life could have been so much easier for him if he had just kept quiet like most doctors do. So the question became,
why put yourself through this?
When you have seen the people that I have seen, and you see that their life just has a few minutes, a few hours before it runs out, and you see that that can be turned around, and you see that years later, these people do have a life, that's the payment that I get. That's why I keep doing what I'm doing.
It was a refreshing ideological position that reminded Garrett of Dr. Gerson, but it still is David and Goliath. In this situation, the American Dental Association wields tremendous power and control over a dentist's life. And the dentist that performed the procedure of proper filling removal on Garrett was terrified of his identity being captured for this movie. Documents had to be signed, which meant that I was personally liable to him for the ruining of his career and income if I did film his face. Hearings on mercury fillings are now taking place in Washington, D.C. that hopefully will put an end to this amalgam disaster. It is estimated that there is 1,000 tons of mercury in the fillings of Americans at the moment. Incredibly, the FDA has never conducted an environmental assessment of the use of dental mercury amalgam as prescribed by law.
It is very important for the Orthodox people to keep patients from coming to alternative treatments because they work. People have been so brainwashed for so long.
But what could possibly be worse than dental health? Certainly food additives couldn't be that bad.
MSG is a tremendously damaging chemical. Monosodium glutamate is actually, it turns off the switch in your brain that says, I've had enough to eat. The problem with MSG, though, it's an excitotoxin.
And just what is an excitotoxin? There are thousands of studies and enough papers on the subject to fill a small library. The evidence has accumulated and then accumulated some more. It's there for anyone to read, but the processed food industry is hoping the media and the average person is too busy, lazy, or unsophisticated enough to be able to understand the subtleties of the science being discussed. But just in case the average layperson does show a bit of curiosity about the dangers of flavor enhancers like MSG, the food industry has smartly printed little rack cards and brochures to give us, defending their crisp position. Garrett met with food experts Jack and Adrian Samuels of Truth in Labeling.
The subject of glutamic acid is very, very complex, and consequently, many games can be played to try to convince people that it is safe. They removed monosodium glutamate from many of their products and replaced monosodium glutamate with other ingredients that gave the consumer no clue to the presence of the reactive component of monosodium glutamate. After being told by my physician, who experienced one of my reactions to MSG, that I would soon die from an MSG exposure if I didn't learn to avoid it, Adrian used her background in research and went to the library, spending some 4,000 hours to read everything she could find about MSG. To her surprise, she found there were studies that indicated that MSG was safe, but they were all sponsored by the glutamate industry or their agents and were all flawed to the point of being worthless. And at the same time, there were many other studies that clearly demonstrated that MSG was toxic and dangerous.
Neuroscientist Dr. John Olney has studied MSG for decades. He rarely gives interviews because of the unwanted attention it incites.
My background is in experimental neuropathology. I conducted a study of monosodium glutamate and its toxicity potential for infant animals, and I found that destroys nerve cells in the developing infant animals' brains.
I could understand his shyness about appearing on camera because he has played a key role in the incriminating evidence against the processed food industry for several years. His findings are shocking to people, especially to parents of young children. But when traveling away from home, the question then becomes for Garrett, what do you eat? At his home in Alaska, where visiting the Gerson family, his diet was virtually devoid of any processed food. It takes a little extra work to seek out delicious organic produce and or restaurants. Stop! After all this, I didn't think. It's too late. The chemicals in this fast food were working their magic on the boy. He ate this meal, actually two meals, like he was possessed. To me, it was disappointing, but to force the issue would likely backfire. He was free to make his own decisions. Hours later, on a plane headed for Jackson, Mississippi, the results were in. In Jackson, Mississippi, the boy met up with an incredible family of photographers, the Blaylocks. Dr. Russell Blaylock is a renowned board-certified neurosurgeon and author of several books on cancer, excitotoxins, and health. It is here where Garrett reoriented himself to a healthy snack, but unbeknownst to the lad, I had a little test planned.
The mass consumption of this excitotoxin substance in the food is interfering with people's ability to think and remember and use language so that our children no longer have the capacity that their parents had. And I think this is getting compounded because there are more and more foods with multiple forms of these excitotoxins, four, five, six, in a single food, so that our children, small children in particular, are consuming such large amounts, it interferes with the development of the brain as well as destroying these connections between the brain cells. And that interferes with brain function, and that's what we're seeing nationwide, and in fact worldwide in the industrialized nations. The reason that the food manufacturers are telling the public that it's safe is because they're making a huge profit off of it. And it's hard to compete with their fellow manufacturers if they don't use the MSG because it's a powerful taste-enhancing effect. So they just tend to ignore all of this research, even though it's literally thousands of studies, and the studies keep growing, proving beyond any doubt in the reasonable mind that, in fact, this is harming people's brains. It's producing gross obesity, metabolic syndrome, diabetes, infantile diabetes, atherosclerosis, a great number of diseases are now connected to what's happening with MSG exposure.
Chips were delivered to the table that were laden with MSG.
One of the things that people don't understand, this can be a silent toxicity. That is, they don't even know it's occurring. A lot of people will tell me, well, I don't react. I don't have these symptoms of nausea and vomiting and headaches. Well, a lot of people that are exposed to MSG will not have these symptoms, but they get the same damage. And this occurs over a very long period of time, decades. So brain cells are being destroyed. And until they lose a number of brain cells, they're not even aware that they're under this toxicity. It's known in neurology that you have to lose about 90% of the neurons in a particular area of the brain before you develop symptoms. So you, by the time you develop these symptoms like dementia or Parkinson's disease, et cetera, you've already lost 90% of the neurons in that part of the brain, and that's what's very important. Another really new important finding is that it's strongly connected to the growth of cancer. And we know that glutamate, when it's increased in a person's diet, makes their cancer grow very rapidly and becomes highly invasive. That means it spreads all over their body. The problem is, no one's telling cancer patients they need to be very cautious about taking in these food additives because it makes their cancer grow much faster and become more invasive, which means they're less likely to survive their cancer.
Garrett never did eat any of those chips. He wants all the brain cells he has. The number of food products that contain MSG but don't actually label it as such is now almost infinite. The only way to avoid this is to buy organic products and whole foods. What the boy also discovered was that this was further confirmation of Gerson's discoveries 80 years earlier. In order to provide a balanced report on the subject of processed foods, the boy then flew from Jackson, Mississippi to Omaha, Nebraska, with the hopes of interviewing a ConAgra Foods public relations representative. After several phone calls and a faxed message, he thought there was reason to be optimistic, but he was wrong. No one at this huge facility would speak. It was confusing and disturbing to the boy temporarily. For me, this heavily guarded facility and non-communicative position was supreme arrogance, especially when considering that they are feeding us, or some of us, every day. It reminded me of facilities in Alaska, such as the military's HARP project, that raises questions about the weather, or my experiences in trying to get interviews with oil companies that turn me down flat. The native people of the North and their concerns are low priority. The boy tried to contact ConAgra twice more with no reply. All was not lost, however. We went to Omaha's Mayberry Park, where Garrett found great delight once more.
We have to go back to Hippocrates. He said, first of all, do no harm. Well, every single drug does harm. Then he also said, let food be your medicine and medicine be your food. That's very important because food will nourish you and heal you. It's natural materials which your body knows how to utilize. Your body has evolved over millions of years to use. Whereas these huge, incredibly profitable companies all over the world are damaging, liver toxic, and cause disease. So how can they really be considered a medicine if they're causing disease?
If we couldn't speak to food manufacturers, then maybe we could speak to a food engineer. Meet Carol Hornline. We met her at the St. Louis, Missouri airport and were driving her to a radio interview. Along the drive, there was plenty of time for sightseeing. Garrett in particular now had time to digest a lot of information. He overheard much of the conversation going on in the front seat about another food additive that made him remember.
In 1974, I petitioned the commissioner of FDA about some evidence I had found pertaining to aspartame causing brain lesions.
But despite all warnings, the former head of G.D. Searle, Donald Rumsfeld, forced it into the food market anyway. As a highly paid and highly respected food engineer, Carol was right in line to work with this dangerous substance. It wasn't long before she was riddled with tumors from her pituitary gland to her ovaries. She ballooned in weight and continues to have health problems. Carol will never be the same again. She no longer wants to work as a food engineer because, quote, I can't work at a place where I'm knowingly poisoning people.
This story is actually worse than the tobacco story because at least you can choose not to smoke. Food, you have no choice.
We were now at the radio station where Carol would have a chance to tell the world her story and what food additives like MSG and aspartame do to any unfortunate organism that comes in contact with it.
Hannity and Mr. Oliver.
This radio program, The Power Hour, can be heard around the world on shortwave radio or the internet every day of the week in rebroadcasts or broadcasts.
To the point where they're leaving their seats and they're going out and becoming activists and they're demonstrating and writing letters.
It's msgtruth.org. That's her website. Now, she became injured as a result of using MSG, but she didn't really use it. It was done to her.
I was basically shoveling aspartame out of a barrel.
Whoa, can you believe that, listeners? Shoveling aspartame out of a barrel.
I've had many, many problems over the years.
What about these tabs? You know the tab drugs?
Yes, the quick dissolve, like the Listerine.
Yeah, quick dissolve.
The Listerine, the Listerine quick dissolve things, those have aspartame in them as well.
Wow.
If the Power Hour show allows people like Carol to speak out on such topics, they have to be creative about staying on the air. Advertisers that support the mainstream media do so because they're able to tout pharmaceuticals, processed foods, and lethal chemicals. Not here. What the Power Hour sells are natural products, food flavorings, books, and DVDs. Host Joyce Riley knew Charlotte Gerson and was familiar with the Gerson therapy. Joyce's background is in the military as a nurse, and the Gulf War affected her with Gulf War syndrome, an illness. She then produced a startling film called Beyond Treason, which documented the serious environmental degradation from U.S. munitions tipped with depleted uranium, as well as experimental vaccines and more. The consequences of these activities are horrifying. Radioactive depleted uranium, for example, has a half-life of 4.5 billion years and has now contaminated regions of the Middle East forever. Joyce explained the Gulf War syndrome suffered by military personnel.
The Gulf War illness is something that is a combination of a lot of toxins. And I couldn't figure out why I was sick because I only flew from Alaska to Cuba during the time that I was a flight nurse, but I became ill. I did have the vaccines. A lot of the troops did have the oil well fire exposure. They had chemicals, biologicals, vaccines, everything involved. What we do know now is that they were full of toxins. I was a nurse for about 35 years, and during that time, I'd done everything from electroconvulsive therapy, which is shock therapy. I'd been a chemo nurse. I was a director of nursing. I was a nurse in a heart, lung, liver, kidney transplant unit, and I never appreciated food at all. I never appreciated what it was for. And then I became ill after the Gulf War, and it was amazing to me that nothing in medicine could make me better, nothing. So I had to start looking into alternative and integrative medicine. Gulf War veterans were becoming ill right after the Gulf War. Thousands of them were becoming ill. And we had no place to turn to. We found out that there were some Gulf War veterans that had been helped by eating raw fruits, or vegetables, fruits, and doing juicing.
When all this talk about vaccines came up, Garrett shared his own feelings about vaccines that are given to infants and school-aged children. There was a 90% reduction in diseases before the vaccines were even introduced, as graphs clearly show. It was improved nutrition that caused the reduction, not vaccines. Vaccines are neurotoxic. And for that reason and awareness, the boy has a clear position on the subject.
Genetically engineered foods are literally lethal.
It was here in San Francisco that the boy had the good fortune to meet the executive director of the Center for Food Safety, Andrew Kimbrell. The Center for Food Safety is a national nonprofit organization working to protect consumers and the environment from the hazards of harmful food production technologies and promote organic and other forms of sustainable agriculture.
One of the great misconceptions we have about genetically engineered food is that the genie is out of the bottle, you know, and you hear all the time 60 or 70% of food's got genetically modified ingredients in it. Not true. 60% of processed food has genetically engineered ingredients. Actually, almost none of your whole foods are genetically engineered. None of your fruits, none of your vegetables, you know, your meat, your fish, most of your dairy products are completely free of genetically engineered ingredients. As a matter of fact, there's only really four genetically engineered crops. That's corn, cotton, canola, and soy. So we have stopped genetically engineered wheat. We've stopped genetically engineered rice. We've stopped genetically engineered fish. We've stopped these biopharmaceuticals. We're seeing that really genetically engineered food is one of the great failures of modern agriculture. It's being rejected around the world. And not only can we stop it, we are stopping it. There are five companies that are behind GMOs. You have Monsanto, DuPont, Bayer, Syngenta, and Dow. Those are the big five companies behind genetically engineered foods. And they all share one thing in common. They're not agricultural companies. They're chemical companies. And there's a reason for that. Genetic engineering today means only one thing. Not all the stuff that's been advertised, all the myths about more food, more nutritious food, tastier food, all nonsense science fiction. These chemical companies have engineered these crops so they can withstand more and more of their herbicides and pesticides. And they selling hundreds of millions of more tons of their chemicals. That's what they're about. I'm not surprised that Monsanto did not want to interview for this film. Monsanto has developed a technology which has one purpose and one purpose alone, which is they can sell more of their herbicides.
Garrett was shocked to find in doing his homework that many of the people that work for these chemical companies later worked in government positions that were supposed to regulate these corporate giants. Sometimes they went back to work for the corporations again. Employees commonly move through what has been coined the revolving door between corporations and the public agencies that regulate them. Monsanto should not have to vouchsafe the safety of biotech food. Our interest is in selling as much as possible. Assuring its safety is the FDA's job. But when this quote is said alongside a statement from the Food and Drug Administration, it simply doesn't give the casual food eater much protection. The boy found this all very disturbing, with zero credibility left over for either group.
Ultimately, it is the food producer who is responsible for assuring safety.
So really, it's up to the good nature of the biotech companies to provide studies to the government. But mostly, this is an unregulated industry, and this is our food.
One of the great questions people ask is, are genetic engineered foods lethal? Are they toxic? And the FDA gave us an answer. The Food and Drug Administration, United States, gave it an answer. In the 80s and 90s, they looked at these foods and said, yes, the process of genetic engineering can take a non-toxic food and make it toxic. It can create new allergens. It can lower nutrition in food. It can lower our immune response. And in certain cases, we even see these foods have the potential to create cancer, certain of this technology. So the answer is in on whether GM foods are lethal or toxic. Yes, the very process can make a safe food and turn it into a toxic food and potentially a lethal food. The objective of Monsanto is clear. Monsanto has become the largest seed company in the world. Monsanto is in the process of buying up all the seeds of the world, which they then want to patent and control so that farmers will not be able to save those seeds. And they want to genetically engineer those seeds, and they want to put something called Terminator technology in those seeds. This has those seeds create suicide after one growing season so that farmers cannot save those seeds. So what Monsanto's really after is controlling all the seeds of the earth and making sure that the farmers of the earth cannot save those seeds. This becomes extremely important when you realize that 80% of all the farmers of the world depend on seed saving for their survival. So if Monsanto is able, either through patenting or through this Terminator technology, to destroy their ability to save seeds, the result will be mass starvation.
Garrett was surprised to learn that controlling pests and all the other reasons chemicals are applied, including artificial fertilizers, is completely unnecessary. There are dozens of institutions in the U.S. alone that strive to declare the good news of sustainable agriculture. Dr. Paul Hepperly demonstrated to us through many seed and field trial studies the amazing ways in which plants thrive and outperform chemically dependent fields. In many instances, the crop yields far exceed chemically treated farms. The studies are extensive, repetitive, and uplifting to anyone who cherishes good health. Dr. Gerson stated that the soil is our external metabolism. It must be free of sprays and poisons, or the body cannot heal. With chemical agriculture, the water that comes from your tap may contain much more than fluoride and chlorine. And there's another food treatment process that could still threaten your health.
What we have found with the irradiation of food is it does not just kill the bacteria, which is what it's used for, but actually molecularly changes the food. It creates something in food called free radicals. These are novel molecular elements in the food that have never been there before. For example, in normal foods, we've seen the creation of benzene, which is a known carcinogen. And we've seen a number of other toxic elements in these food created because of the irradiation that fundamentally alter that food. So we have an ethical responsibility to eat well. The beautiful truth is that people around the world are saying no to GM foods, they're saying no to irradiation, they're saying no to food additives, and they're saying yes to organic food and beyond organic food. They're saying yes to food that is local, that is appropriate scale, that is humane, that's biodiverse, and that's socially just.
Garrett thought that one way to stop some of this is by the way we vote, if indeed you can trust the voting machines to work right. How could a man who was curing cancer and chronic disease over 80 years ago be so misunderstood? It was now even within reach for this 15-year-old boy to understand. Is it at this point a race against time to consider the gift Gerson offered the world so long ago before we exceed the tipping point merely from an environmental standpoint? During the course of our travel, Garrett noted an article in the paper about obesity. After what he had learned, it wasn't a bit surprising. With all these chemicals and craving for more chemicals and more refined foods and sugar, we are bound to be obese and die that way. The Ohio Valley is the casket-making capital of the world. Naturally, the boy had wondered what eventually happens to an oversized dead person. Here at Goliath Casket Company, this family-owned business is experiencing a booming market, which Garrett credited to pharmaceutical drugs, MSG, aspartame, vaccines, food irradiation, genetically modified foods, dental amalgams, water fluoridation, and root canals, to name a few. Even the standard-sized casket is an inch wider than it used to be.
Most people won't get in one because they're afraid to do that. That's a omen, bad omen.
This would actually be quite nice for a cabin up in Alaska in the summer. You can close the lid in there, you wouldn't get any light, and you could sleep better.
Most of the people are not taller, but they're wider and deeper. One of the issues we have with oversized obesity and oversized people is that they're very wide and they're also very much thicker or deeper. So our caskets have to be designed to accommodate this problem. Also, when they ask for a cremation, and many times they cannot do the cremation because the doors on the retort aren't big enough. Also, if they can do that, they have to be very careful of how they process the body in the retort to prevent the retort from catching on fire because of all the excess body fluids that may catch on fire and also cause the retort to burn down.
With all this cross-country travel, we had to stop. It was the home of Garrett's maternal grandmother. The boy's mother was killed in a freak accident recently. The tragedy made Garrett more aware of the fragility of life. And if living is within our control, then we should strive to stay healthy. All living things have a distinctive energy field around them that can be measured and even photographed. Garrett remembered before he left on this trip an experiment with an aerospace engineer named Christopher Watke. In this take, what this engineer demonstrated was a comparison between a slice of cooked and uncooked organic baby carrot. The cooked carrot is on the left. The uncooked is on the right. The uncooked carrot has a startling line of strong energy that's clearly lacking in this cooked carrot that was steamed for 10 minutes. What this means is that pasteurized food is dead. Garrett held a funeral for the latest victim, the almond. We then tried the experiment with a piece of conventionally grown apple and a piece of organically grown apple. The results were more subtle, but the apple piece on the right is organically grown, the left conventionally grown. An organically grown tomato. A conventionally grown tomato. The photographic technique utilizes 50,000 volts and a broad range of frequencies to resonate with the test objects, capturing their patterns for analysis, whether living or non-living. The boy found the results consistent and fascinating, an area of study that needs a closer look.
Kirlian photography is the iridology of the future, where we can see markers in the aura that's around people's bodies. And these markers indicate where their health is deficient and where their health is fine.
All of the homework that Garrett did was finally coming together. His study of the Gerson therapy was now close to completion. The Gerson therapy is no secret, never has been, and it works. It is simple, but requires compliance and dedication. Very basically, it utilizes fresh-pressed organic juices, delicious organic meals, and, oh yes, coffee, as in coffee enemas. Dr. Gerson gave an example of 50 recovered patients in his original book in the late 1950s that was representative of thousands of recoveries at that time. All the patients were diagnosed with extremely detailed records at leading medical centers around the country. During and after the treatment, the medical records from independent medical centers bear out the results, and the results bear out a beautiful truth. Gerson cured his good friend Dr. Albert Schweitzer of adult onset diabetes, and then his wife of lung tuberculosis, and then his daughter of a rare skin disease. It is something Schweitzer would never forget, and they exchanged letters up until Gerson's death in 1959. The cancer industry is about money and drugs, yet all the money in the world won't save you if you make the wrong decision. You might as well be homeless. The boy is certain that many of the famous and talented would have changed history and culture if they could have only known.
Garrett, on the question of what does the pancreas do? Essentially, the job of the pancreas is to digest food.
The pancreas has a key role to play in the Gerson therapy, and in this boy's simple graphic, it is clear the human intestinal tract is longer than that of the carnivore. The digestion in a human becomes quite compromised if he starts to eat animal protein, stressing the pancreas as well as the digestive tract.
But the pancreas has one additional very important job, and that is to protect the body from malignant cells. The pancreas recognizes malignant cells if they develop and digests and kills them, gets rid of them. When you overload the pancreas, as most Americans do, with excess animal protein foods, all the jobs, all the ability of the pancreas is used up just trying to digest and get rid of all this animal products, and there's nothing left to protect you from the malignant cells. The immune system is paralyzed.
Then the question was posed to Howard by the Slovenian guest how the coffee enema works.
Why?
Well, what happened was that the caffeine in the coffee enema was absorbed by the hemorrhoidal vein, which is wrapped around your descending colon. Uh-huh. That is a vein, it's a drainage system, not a distribution system like an artery. So that's part of the portal venous system, which then brings the caffeine directly to the liver, directly to the liver.
Okay.
Not just the caffeine, but also some of the other elements of coffee.
Okay.
Cafestol and kaweol.
Okay.
And potassium.
And potassium, very important, potassium.
Yep. Okay.
So then the liver is stimulated to produce glutathione S transferase and bile. Now what mm-hmm. glutathione S transferase does, it is a blood cleansing enzyme. Mm-hmm. Of course, pharmaceutical companies have wanted to produce something that would stimulate glutathione S transferase, but they can't patent it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they could clean the blood, that would be wonderful, but they can't.
Okay.
So we say, coffee enema, coffee enema.
Okay.
And they say, go away, kid, we can't patent that.
The coffee enema is prepared with 3 tablespoons of fine ground organic coffee. Then it is simmered for 15 minutes. It is then poured through a filter into a 1-quart container. Distilled water is also added to restore it to a quart. Then it is poured into an enema bucket. Once the coffee has drained into the patient lies on his right side, knees drawn up for approximately 10 to 13 minutes, and then evacuates. But in order for the boy to truly be impacted on a personal level, he needed to meet cancer patients to believe it for himself. No more pictures, no more books. Garrett wanted to go to Mexico. Surprised at how pleasant the surroundings were and how happy the cancer patients seemed. They were here from all over the world. Garrett ate with them and listened to their stories. The laboratory tests on the patients are extensive and carefully watched. Most patients only stay at the clinic 1 to 3 weeks and then go home to recover. One of the patients from New Zealand was eager to visit with Garrett.
So how long have you been here?
3 weeks yesterday. I came here straight from the Mayo Clinic in Florida, and I've got melanoma in my bones, spine, leg, liver, lungs, and lymphs. Since I've been here, inside myself I feel hugely different, much stronger physically, and I've lost the nausea. Within myself I feel 100% better than when I came. So I came here from the Mayo Clinic. They told me that I had 4 to 6 months to live if I didn't do chemo, and if I did chemo, I would have 6 to 8 months to live with what I have. If I had really good chemo, that's like top of the line, and I responded, I might have a year. So looking at those options, I decided to look elsewhere. My sister flew over to meet me, and she was reading Ian Gula's book about his recovery from cancer. He had bone cancer, where he was given 2 weeks to live. And after trying the Gerson therapy for several months and then adapting it, he's now still alive and has got the Ian Gula Foundation in Australia. I trust it actually with my life. That's why I'm here.
And I'm talking to Mrs. Gerson and talking
and
to
And then me. Howard and Garrett spoke with one of the clinic's doctors.
Cases that
and
we
what,
have.
And what do you see? What do you see in the first few days of
In the first few days with doing the coffee enemas, I started to notice changes. Their pain starts to diminish, their energy is increasing. Patients that come here the first day with blood pressure blood pressure in the first week disappears. Goodbye taking blood pressure medications. Oh, yeah. And the patients aren't realizing, you know what, there's something more here than just a coffee enema and detox and organic diet and juices. They start to see the changes. And as I start to believe in what the hope they're believing, and I tell them, it's more than hope. It's a reality.
Reality.
And it starts changing their way of life.
And you, as a physician, must get phenomenal satisfaction.
It excites me. Yeah. Unbelievable. To see changes in the blood work, in the x-rays, something that I can actually touch, feel, because I see these patients every day.
From Tijuana, Garrett traveled south to meet a cancer patient that was recovering against all odds, at home with the Gerson therapy. In the mountains outside San Cristobal de las Casas, Howard Strauss guided Garrett to meet this patient, who is the same age as Garrett. Her name is Lupita. Lupita overcame a cancer called an ovarian teratoma, which has astounded her doctor. Utilizing the Gerson therapy under extremely difficult conditions proved to Garrett that anything is possible if one simply has faith. For Lupita, fresh organic vegetables and fruits are not difficult to find. Ironically, truly organic produce in the United States is harder to come by. The Gerson Institute in San Diego has extensive files of case histories for anyone to see.
12 months after the diagnosis of prostate cancer, I was cancer-free within 12 months. And that was proven by the MRI and other imaging tests that I had, and which found amazingly that the cancer was completely gone from my sacrum, from my pelvis, from my liver, and from the prostate. 32 months after diagnosis, I did yet another MRI, a second MRI, and that reconfirmed that the cancer was completely gone from my body, in all areas of my body. And if anyone doubts this, I have all the medical records to prove it. I brought all the medical records with me, from the doctor's reports to the scans to the imagings, and they prove it without beyond a doubt. It's just an amazing thing.
The pathology reports speak for themselves. Garrett found recovered patients everywhere with proof from their doctors.
The Gerson therapy cured my fibromyalgia.
But then I showed Garrett footage I had taken almost 5 years ago of a patient that was given a death sentence by conventional medicine. She had extra ovarian primary peritoneal carcinoma, stage 4. No one had ever recovered from such a cancer using orthodox medicine. So here she was, using the Gerson therapy in a last-ditch effort. And now, 5 years later, Garrett was looking at the results. Was he reading her obituary? This was her story.
He leaves the room and goes, you know, down the hall for a minute, and he comes back in the door and he crosses his hands across his chest, and just in astonishment he looks at me and he says, "You're the only patient we have seen that has survived this diagnosis." He said, "This is unheard of." And so I told him that if he ever got sick to give me a call and I would help him.
Garrett wanted to push this further, and so he asked this patient to go back to the Mayo Clinic to get a statement from her diagnostic doctor that the Gerson therapy cured her. The Mayo Clinic went into a panic mode because the doctor did want to appear on camera, but he was cut off. It became a waiting game.
We would much appreciate it. He'd be making a big difference for the treatment of cancer and the environment.
The answer came with the police, and they ushered her away thinking she was a terrorist. As a result, the doctor is quitting the Mayo Clinic to work without such restrictive boundaries. But there are many others.
In 1986, I was diagnosed with pancreas cancer, which has spread to my liver, gallbladder, and spleen. The doctors told me I had 3 months to live, to go home, get my finances in order, and prepare to die.
She did the Gerson therapy over 20 years ago. Garrett remembered where he started with his homeschool lesson. It all came back to him quite quickly.
No, I don't think there's any evidence that anybody's ever been cured by Gerson therapy.
It's not right from any aspect at all.
Well, has the Gerson therapy ever cured a cancer patient?
Well, of course not. They won't even release their records.
I don't believe there's any proof that the Gerson therapy works. In other words, Charlotte Gerson was lying.
There are laws against healing cancer. The doctor is not allowed to try anything else. He must use only those treatments that have already proven to be failures. Imagine what we could do if this could be accepted.
What I'd like to see is some proof, some good scientific proof. Scientific proof, scientific proof, scientific proof, proof.
The cancer industry is big business, using useless treatments such as chemotherapy and radiation, and continues to persuade the public that they're still searching for a cure. A documentary called Healing Cancer from the Inside Out by Mike Anderson put it well.
The American Cancer Society was formed with the backing of John D. Rockefeller, and it has functioned as a mouthpiece for the cancer industry, not the public, ever since. The American Cancer Society's mission statement says, they are dedicated to eliminating cancer as a major health problem. The Chronicle of Philanthropy reports, however, that the ACS is more interested in accumulating wealth than in saving lives. The ACS, in fact, is the wealthiest nonprofit in the world, with net assets over $1 billion. Not surprisingly, it has consistently been given the lowest rankings in charity evaluations. Despite this wealth, its aggressive fundraising campaign pleads poverty and laments the lack of available money for cancer research. Aside from high salaries and overhead, most of what is left in the ACS budget goes into research that directly benefits pharmaceutical and radiological companies. What you see from studies conducted over the last 50 years is that for our major cancers, the effectiveness of conventional treatments is far less than a sugar pill.
Board members of the American Cancer Society have included herbicide and pesticide manufacturers.
Before Garrett returned to Alaska, there was one more person he wanted to meet. His name is Jay Cordage, known by millions as the Juice Man. Jay is responsible for selling close to $1 billion of juicers throughout the world.
Well, Garrett, you know, I've been doing this now since 1948, ever since I had cancer of the urinary bladder. You know, when I think back, I just finished playing football for the University of Southern California, and I was drafted by Curly Lambeau and the Green Bay Packers. And then this urinary problem started. I started to pass blood, and I found out I had a tumor in my urinary bladder. And I had remembered a class that I had on one of my physiology classes, human anatomy classes, and I had inadvertently read about Dr. Max Gerson treating Dr. Albert Schweitzer, you know? And I figured, my God, after I found out I had cancer of the bladder, I figured if this treatment was good enough for Dr. Albert Schweitzer, it's gotta be good enough for me.
Never believe that much good could come out of it. This is the juice that saved my life when I had cancer of the bladder. The Gerson treatment, carrot and apple.
Because of that, I'm here. All the drinks that I made, and I continue even today, and this has been how long? Wow, 1948. My words of advice to you, bring the power of plants into your body. There's nothing like freshly made juices to nurture your 100 trillion cells.
Garrett was now 6 miles from home. His homeschool lesson was officially over. The memories of the trip still glowed red hot in his mind. Specifically, how could he possibly forget a woman who carries on her father's work relentlessly against all opposition? Who carries the torch of a way of life that is health care, not some government agency's plan hatched with a collection of drug companies? Believe in hope. He believes he has a future. He believes that environmental issues that confront humanity will dissolve into collective solutions. After all, this is our only home, and we are rational human beings. Could see hope on the local level. Garrett couldn't wait to bring this fresh pressed carrot juice to his neighbor John.
I'd like to see some scientific proof.
Our other neighbor, Bob, the one that milks the goats and was quite skeptical, was really liking what he was hearing, and so was his wife, up until...
Okay, so here you want to add 3 tablespoons of coffee into your boiling water, then you want to let it simmer for 12 minutes. And you pour it in a quart jar and add water so it ends up being a quart. Then you connect the tube to your Rs, then you let the coffee drain into your Rs, then you let it sit for 12 minutes, then you release it into the bathroom toilet.
On another level, I think I learned more from this journey than my son, and for that, I'll be forever grateful. For each of us eventually, whether we're ready or not, someday it will come to an end. There will be no more sunrises, no minutes, hours, or days. All the things you collected, whether treasured or forgotten, will pass to someone else. Your wealth, fame, and temporal power will shrivel to irrelevance. It will not matter what you owned or owed. Your grudges, resentments, frustrations, and jealousies will finally disappear. So too your hopes, ambitions, plans, and to-do lists will expire. The wins and losses that once seemed so important will fade away. It won't matter where you came from or on what side of the tracks you lived at the end. It won't matter if you're beautiful or brilliant. Even your gender and skin color will be irrelevant. So what will matter? How will the value of your days be measured? What will matter is not what you bought, but what you built. Not what you got, but what you gave. What will matter is not your success, but your significance. What will matter is not what you learned, but what you taught. What will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, or sacrifice that enriched, empowered, or encouraged others to emulate your example. What will matter is not your competence, but your character. What will matter is not how many people you knew, but how many will feel a lasting loss when you're gone. What will matter is not your memories, but the memories that live in those who loved you. A life lived that matters is not of circumstance, but of choice.